COVID-19 is ravaging Europe, and we are perhaps nearing the peak of the second wave. For many countries, it is worse than the first. But what lessons can we take from the different ways the pandemic's being handled? This is Roundtable. Hello from me, David Foster. Well, today we are going to get insight from four European countries on how they are dealing with coronavirus. And first, the United Kingdom, a country that has seen the total number of cases pass 3 million, with nearly 85,000 deaths out of every 1 million people. At least 47,000 have had the virus. And the UK was the first country to roll out a mass vaccination programme. I'm very pleased to be able to say we can welcome to the programme once again from Exeter in the United Kingdom, David Strain, Senior Clinical Lecturer at the University of Exeter Medical School. David, good to have your company again. I know you've been ever so busy since the last time we spoke, and we can see behind you a bed that they've moved into your office in case it's needed. Tough on you, but do you think the UK is coming in for unfair criticism, looking at the newspaper headlines about the way it's handled the pandemic?
We're only really going to get the full grasp of the different strategies that have been implemented at the end of this pandemic. I have to admit, at the moment, the UK is not doing particularly well. We have more cases than the rest of Europe. And when it comes to deaths per million, which is actually the standard that we should be looking at, we're also not doing as well as many other parts of the country. I think we are just behind Italy at the moment, but numbers continue to climb. I do think the UK could have done better when we came out of the first wave. I think we came out of our first wave of lockdowns too quickly, and we wanted to try and get society moving again too quickly. We have learned. We are back in lockdown. We are, at the moment, having unparalleled stress with our health service. And we are hoping that as we come out of this with the vaccination programme going ahead, we could get back to normal sooner than many other parts of the world.
But let me ask you this. When it comes to any kind of lockdown, the moment you open the gates again, the moment people have their freedoms restored, unless the virus has disappeared completely, it is going to reappear and it is going to move through society far faster than it had done during lockdown. So no matter what the government did, this was always going to happen, wasn't it?
It was. And there were many of us at the British Medical Association when we were looking at the exit strategy that we had after the first wave that were rather disappointed that we reduced the 2 metres to 1 metre, that we were probably one of the last in Europe to implement mandatory masks when you were out and about. And actually, over summer, our government put a strategy to try and actively encourage people to get together, to try and get the economy going. These are all steps that, with retrospect, I would say were mistakes. And what we need to do is learn from that. And know that when we come out of the current lockdown we're in, we wait until the rates are much lower in the community and we come back into an artificial world where we go back to our 2 meter physical distancing. The masks become mandatory for everyone. And the important thing that we also need to add is although the vaccine is seen as a way of reducing the burden on hospitals, we still don't know whether any of these vaccines will stop the transmission and the spread. And so the vaccines are not going to be the immediate return to normality that many are hoping for.
So let me ask you this. With vaccination, do you think people are looking at it and believing that salvation is just around the corner, therefore we need not necessarily be as strict with ourselves over the rules as before? Because pretty soon we're all going to be okay.
We did see that, and actually in the run-up to Christmas that we had, there was a noticeable reduction of people's awareness, a reduction in the distancing, and people were using Christmas as an excuse to get together. And at this moment in time, we are seeing the highest peak of COVID hospitalization and deaths that we've seen in the entire pandemic. And that is all a result of the mixing that took place just after the announcement of the vaccine.
Let me ask you about suggestions in newspapers I've been reading this week that actually having had the illness, once you've recovered, it is as good as having had the vaccine because you have the antibodies and you're not going to get it nearly as seriously as you would have done before. Is that a good thing, or is that going to once again encourage people to think that we're past the worst?
It's all swings and roundabouts. So you get 83% protection if you've had the virus before. That still means 17% of people will get it again. And the important thing is they are potentially spreading it. We're seeing the new variants arising that are easier to transmit. So even if you only get a much more mild disease for a shorter time, if you get it again, you can still pass that onwards. So we are a long way out of the woods, and we do need to remind people that that is the case.
Anybody, any country got it right, or are we just still in the land of the unknown?
We are still in the land of the unknown. If you'd have asked me earlier on, I would have said Germany got it absolutely right because they had a very low mortality by doing rapid tests. We saw there were good strategies that happened in Italy where they managed to, although they had very high rates in the Lombardy region, they managed to prevent it spreading across the whole of the country. However, as this goes on, as the virus mutates and it starts to spread, I really think the only route out of this is going to be a vaccination and a big change in our behaviour for at least the next 12 months or so.
Amazing. Listen, thank you so much. Good to see you again on this programme. David, sorry to hear you're working so hard that you're having to spend nights at the hospital. We wish you many nights at home rather than in the bed in your office. Pretty soon, we hope. Thanks for coming on the show. Well, we're going to take a look at Greece now, a country which did pretty well during the first wave of COVID across Europe. Numbers are going up, or at least they have been for a few months. In total, in the country, more than 146,000 cases, more than 5,000 deaths. And out of every 1 million people, at least 14,000 have had the virus. The country currently imposing a lockdown, which includes a nighttime curfew. Let's welcome to the programme Emmanuel Demitzakis, Professor at the Department of Genetic Medicine at the University of Geneva Medical School. Happens to be in Switzerland, but we're talking, Emmanuel, about your home country of Greece. I said numbers have been rising, but compared to November, there's been a dramatic drop in the number of cases. Do you think Greece has handled all of this pretty well?
I mean, relative to other countries, certainly there's been a difference in the approach of the country. I think that Greece actually did not so well in the second wave back in November, partly because they followed the stream of the other countries in the European Union. There almost seemed like there was a coordinated approach to when they will close down or how long they will stay open. And I think at that moment, Greece, instead of using the mentality and the principles that they used in the first wave, they got carried away into a longer process and wait until they implemented the measures. The amazing thing that happened is that there's been a lockdown that is pretty strict. You need an SMS to go out. Certain activities are restricted. You cannot, teleworking is highly encouraged. The reduction of cases has been relatively slow, as we've seen in other countries. But what has been amazing is that during the Christmas and New Year's period, cases kept going down. So if you see the aftermath of this period, which is basically, we see it now almost 2 weeks after New Year's, the cases are going down instead of going up. So contrary to many other countries...
Can you help me with that one? Because we were hearing from David Strain in Exeter that across the Christmas period, the holiday period, numbers in the UK have accelerated. We're waiting to see what's happened after that. Why would Greece have a fall over the same period of time? What did it do differently?
Well, I cannot compare every single country, but in Greece, it was actually very difficult, given the measures, to have, you know, parties and big celebrations. There was actually the regulations were that no more than 9 people could be found at any place at the same time, even during the holidays, during the period of Christmas and New Year's. And Greeks actually were very careful about this. They followed that. I think they realized that this would actually return back into more freedom later on. And in fact, what we see now is the numbers are significantly lower. There was a reduction in cases, which made the Greek government start thinking about opening up some of the activities.
You're a doctor who understands the way that diseases spread. I'm wondering if in the UK, which has a lot of large urban population centres, no matter how much you restrict the gatherings, people are going to be in closer proximity than in a country like Greece, which, apart from Athens and a few big towns in the north, a lot of the population's spread out.
Yes, I mean, that helps too. But I think we didn't see, for example, the Harrods-like images that we saw in the UK during the holidays, you know, for shopping. We didn't have that in Greece. That was never possible in Greece. The shops since November never opened in that way. We had this mechanism called click away, which effectively means click and collect. So people were just calling or e-shopping and then would collect it from the shop. So we never had that kind of explosion of activity, which of course led to an explosion of cases in other countries. So I think what is important to keep in mind is that the mentality and the approach of the Greek government was much more health-oriented than economy-oriented. And the idea behind it was something that was a realization in the first phase that keeping the country safe and people safe, although it has a significant cost at the economy immediately, it can actually be branding the country in a different way long-term, as a safe country, as a country that takes care of its citizens, something that Greece has not done in the past. So the government actually capitalized on that, is planning to do that, and that's where they put a lot of emphasis on keeping people healthy and keeping those restrictions rather than opening the economy, keeping it wide open to let money circulate.
That's really interesting. So it's a means of, if you convince people that the benefits are going to be there in the long term, not just health-wise, but economically, they will follow the rules.
To some extent. I mean, at the end, you know, we're still Greeks. We still have the temperament. We still like to, you know, violate the regulations from time to time. But it's still something that, you know, Greeks tend to, concentrate around a goal. So if you set a goal, they would work on it with some deviations, of course. It's a different kind of mentality. We're easy to break the rule. We're easy to follow the rule, depending on the motivation. I think in this stage where we are now, of course, there's a lot of reactions. People want to start their normal life, as in every other place in the world. But there's a certain degree of loyalty to what we're trying to do as Greeks. And the country is small.
I've got to be quick on this, Emmanuel, beg your pardon.
Sure.
What about with vaccinations? Where do you stand as a country?
Well, vaccination is going relatively well. We're about at the average in terms of the rate of vaccination. You know, you have to realize that, for all countries, the small numbers of doses that have been delivered, especially for vaccines like Pfizer or Moderna or eventually AstraZeneca, that are 2 doses, you need to be very careful to make sure that you have the second dose in place. So you cannot just, you know, massively vaccinate everybody on the first day and then wait for the second dose whenever it comes. So this has been at the...
Emmanuel, I'm going to have to stop you. Thank you very, very much indeed. Time is tight.
Thank you very much.
We appreciate the fact that you gave us your time. Well, at this stage in the programme, we head to France. There, the total number of cases, well, it's past 2.8 million now. Around 69,000 people have lost their lives after being infected with COVID-19. Out of every 1 million people, at least 43,000 in France have had the virus. And according to French health authorities, about 25,000 people are currently in hospital with COVID-19. To tell us about the situation there, we have Antoine Flao, Director of the Institute of Global Health at the University of Geneva. Great to have you with us, Antoine. The government's health advisory body in France, called the Conseil Scientifique, the head of that has said he believes that France is 2 months behind the UK in terms of the spread of the new variant of COVID-19. Does that mean that the worst is yet to come, perhaps, in France?
It's very difficult to predict the future, at least beyond 1 or 2 weeks in this pandemic, as we have seen from the early beginning. So I will not try to predict what will happen. What is sure is that the UK has seen for one consecutive month surge in their epidemic activity with a reproductive rate which was above 1.2 for 30 consecutive days before taking measures, lockdown measures. What is trying the French government today is to be more proactive, to take measures much before this level of circulation of the new variant has happened. In that way, I think it is really a precaution principle to do that.
And is it working, would you say? Because I think the curfew's been extended. Schools are still open, but there are some rules around there. But there are still limits on what people can and cannot do. Does it so far appear that that's being effective?
Yes, it's a good question, because what is known to be effective is total lockdown. But lockdown, of course, have a lot of side effects, a lot of impact on the social and economic life. So the governments in Europe are trying to find some intermediate solutions to take over control of its wave, of its surge, by taking early measures which are not as strict as these lockdowns the UK had been obliged to implement due to the worsening situation. So today,
if I've got it right, what you're saying is there are a lot of little measures rather than some big measures, and that perhaps appears to be better.
Yes, it will be better. I don't know if it will be better. Of course, lockdown is more effective than a curfew. The curfew is a kind of partial lockdown, we can say. It's a night lockdown, but it's far less impactful on the social and economic life. It's a strong measure. It's a strong limitation of the freedom of movement in the night, in the evening. You know, Paris has a nightlife which was very, very pleasant. So it's a real burden, but it's far less impactful than a strict lockdown. So what they are doing now is trying to avoid these very, very impactful measures, and we will see if it is effective. What is sure is the situation is not so bad today in most continental European countries, so they probably can try this intermediate solution before trying a very severe and strict lockdown.
Can I put this one to you? I mean, as a doctor rather than as a French citizen, where do you believe the state perhaps got it wrong in France?
Oh, it's very difficult to tackle this pandemic. The Europeans were much too reactive than proactive. If we compare the Western European countries with Asian countries, and I'm talking about democracies like Taiwan, like Japan, like the South Korea, they try to be very proactive, meaning that at the early stage of circulation of the viruses, they took a strong measure to limit that circulation, that progression. In Europe, we used to wait too much, too long, that the situation become worse and worse. And at that time, when, because of a risk of an overwhelming of the healthcare systems, we had to take measures and lockdown measures. I think we may have learned a bit from the experience of the champion in the world. Also some Nordic countries like Norway and Finland behave very, very well, much closer to the Japanese government or the Taiwanese one. So we have learned, okay, I think, some lessons from that.
Dr. Flau, Antoine, thank you very much indeed. And in fact, we're looking at a Nordic country in just a moment. But for now, from you, we thank you. Well, finally, in this program, we're going to look at Sweden, which famously took a rather relaxed approach to COVID regulations at the start of it all. Things have changed a little bit. Sweden's total cases now number over 500,000, with almost 10,000 deaths. Out of every 1 million people, more than 50,000 have had the virus. And more people are being treated for COVID-19 at hospitals in Sweden now than at any time during the pandemic. Hospitals apparently said to be nearing their limit, according to a senior scientist there. Let's go to Stockholm, talk to Anna-Mia Ekström, the clinical professor in infectious disease epidemiology at the Karolinska Institute. Very good to have you with us. Do you go along with the headline I saw on one major news website today that Sweden is finally tightening COVID measures after being slammed by the virus?
I think it is a little bit exaggerated. I think if you look at the number of cases in intensive care, for example, it's not more now than it was in the spring, and survival rates are much better. As of the report from yesterday from the National Board of Health and Welfare, we have about a 20% margin of in ICU care, while I think we were more, it was more tight in the spring. But yes, hospital staff are tired, and there are still a lot of patients in the hospital, although it seems like it's declining a bit, both in terms of intensive care patients, but also more clearly in the number of deaths over the last 2 weeks. We don't know if that's is something that will be, you know, sustainable, but hopefully so.
Anna-Mia, does this mean that when Sweden adopted its what I call rather relaxed approach at the beginning of all of this, it actually got it slightly wrong?
I think we had every country is different, and because Sweden is not as crowded as many other countries, it is also easier to keep a distance. What I think many people have misunderstood a little bit is that Sweden was super relaxed, which I don't think actually. That's not how we really experienced it here. But I think Sweden did differ in some instances, for example, in the requirement of face masks that wasn't there in the spring, that has been introduced more now. It's not mandatory to wear a face mask all the time, but it is to be used in public transport. And of course, it has been throughout the pandemic in all instances where in elderly care, all care situations, obviously. So in that respect, Sweden was different, but in many other ways, the recommendations were actually quite similar: to work from home, to keep distance. You know, in many ways, I think Sweden has had a similar strategy in practice, although
so
we never
went into. Let me ask you this. So when Sweden appeared to be doing the right thing, because there were, at the beginning of all of this, fewer infections. It may well have been, and I've read your suggestion about this, it may well have been, in your opinion, that a lot of people in Sweden had immunity long before you really knew the seriousness of this COVID epidemic.
Well, I think that was the case among many researchers. We did hope and think that immunity would protect us more than it probably did. We didn't know then, it was impossible because this is a new virus, to know how long this immunity would last for. But possibly the fact that we did have probably some immunity, at least in parts of the population, that's why the second wave hit Sweden later than many other European countries, meaning that we have peaked a bit later. But we really didn't even see. We only saw the beginning of the second wave in early November, while in many other countries it came earlier. So that could have played in, okay. Because, yeah, but we don't know. And at least we have seen, we've had a second wave that is as strong as the first wave.
Give us a quick thought, and I'm sorry to have to push you on this, and on how you think Sweden's private healthcare has helped alleviate the pressures on the public system.
Honestly, I think Sweden's major problem in the spring, and it still hasn't been, you know, fully corrected, is the fact that we've had a very decentralized healthcare system with a lot of different actors. So it was actually quite hard in the beginning to organize it all and to make people follow the recommendations. And there was a huge lack of personal protective equipment also in the beginning. And Sweden was also quite late in getting access to tests in a proper meaning. So,
but that changed.
That has changed. It's now we were testing very much, and PPE is available everywhere. But I think it has been, which is different between the Nordic countries, actually, that some healthcare systems are much more centralized. And then it's, of course, easier to get recommendations implemented. While in Sweden, this was hard due to the multitude of actors, in particular in the Stockholm region, which was hit hardest and first in Sweden.
We thank you very much indeed for joining us on this edition of Roundtable. That is Anna-Mia Ekström talking to us from Stockholm. And we thank our three other guests for joining us to talk about the United Kingdom, to talk about France and Greece. Well, for me, David Foster, wherever you happen to be watching this edition of Roundtable, we thank you very much for your company. Hope to have you next time. Until then, goodbye.